my friends here, Kimberly, and is that your daughter or grandbaby?
It's actually a friend of mine.
Okay, and her sweet name is Olivia, correct? Did I say that right, baby? All right. Let's all stand tonight. Good to be in the house of God. Good to be here. Make way for your neighbor. We'll make sure everybody's got plenty of room. Amen. I'm so glad to be here with my friends and brothers and sisters in Christ. It's just awesome to be here tonight. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Father, we love you. We reverence you, Jesus. We thank you, God, that we have another opportunity to be with you, Father. And Lord, we're especially gracious for the blood of Jesus that has been shed, Lord, for the remission of our sins, and not our sins only, God, but all of the world, Father. We're so humbled, God, that you would leave heaven, Father, and come down, Lord. And in this Christmas season, Father, we thank you for the virgin birth. We thank you, Father, for the supreme sacrifice that you made, Jesus, so that we could all have access to heaven. We could all partake in eternal life through the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Have your way in this service tonight, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. If you would fellowship for a second, tell somebody you love him, and then we're going to start worship tonight. We're going to worship the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, listen, everybody take out the red hymn book in front of you. We're going to do a request tonight, or if you have a song that's already on your heart, speak it out, and we'll do our best to try to sing it tonight. We'll do our best to try to sing it tonight. Sorry for the heat. Somehow the heat was stuck, and it was like 82 degrees when we first walked in here. All right, does anyone have a request? Don't everybody shout them out at one time? All right. Dana, give us one. Give us a request out of the red book. Huh? You know, you got to know what number it is. Everybody, every respectable Christian has a 333.
She grew up with a screen. She don't know page numbers.
There you go. All right. Matthew, which one you got? Don't give us one we don't know. I don't
start that flyway, okay?
Oh, don't you love? Yeah, Matthew done went way back. I'll fly away. Let's sing it tonight. Amen. Well, some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away. Well, to the home on God's celestial shore. Away. Come on, y'all sing it now. All right, Matthew, which is that song? Which song is it?
I have to look. I'm not sure if I remember it.
How about this? Pick another one because none of us know that one.
I'm not sure that I remember it.
Faith About Fathers?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm not sure that I remember it. I'm looking up quick. But
pick one more. We'll learn that one for next Sunday.
Jehovah is leading you, page 191.
Yeah, you picking all of them that we don't know. Aren't you?
Yeah, you're going to have to pick one we know, brother. I think he just randomly, like, I like the title of that one. I got one. 212, keep on the fire line.
All right.
Y'all have to help me sing. My voice is rough tonight, but we, y'all help us sing. Well, if you're in the battle for the Lord and right, keep on the firing line. If you win, my brother, surely you must fight. Keep on the firing line. There are many dangers that we all must face. If we die of fighting, it is no disgrace. Coward in the service, he will find no place. Oh, keep on the fire. Come on, sing it now. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the right, just keep on the firing line. Well, God will only use a soldier he can trust. Keep on the firing line. If you wear a crown, then bear the cross you must. Keep on the firing line. Life is but to labor for the master dear. Help to banish evil and to spread good cheer. Great you'll be rewarded for your service here. So keep on, come on, sing it, church. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the right, just keep on the fight. Come on, y'all sing the last verse now. From the paths of sin, with the shout of welcome, we will all march in. Just keep on the firing line. Well, you must
fight, be brave against all. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the right, just keep on the firing line.
Amen. All right, someone else give us one more tonight. 92.
Just a little talk with Jesus.
Oh, yes. Y'all sounded good out there tonight. I saw like I was swallowing a frog.
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. And then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It made my heart in love, and it wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus made me whole. Have a little talk with Jesus, let us know. He will hear, he will answer. When you feel, then you'll know. You will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Sometimes my sad seems drear, without a ray of cheer. Then a cloud of doubt may hide the light of day. The mist of sin may rise and hide the starry skies. Just a little talk with Jesus clears away. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us
tell him all about our trouble.
He will hear. He will answer. When you feel
a little prayer will turn,
then you'll know
the fire is burning.
You will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Tears. Jesus is friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer. He knows my every care. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our trouble.
He will hear.
Hear our faintest cry.
And he will answer. Now when you
feel a little prayer will turn it.
Then you'll know
a little fire is burning.
You will find
a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Let us
tell him all about our trouble.
He will
hear. Glory to God. Amen. How many likes? I like this tonight. That's good. All right, how about one more? We'll have the deacons come up, a couple of our ushers. Amen. Tony, will you help do offering tonight? Let's do the old rugged cross. How about that one? That's a beautiful one. All right. Father, thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to bless you, Father. Lord, we know you own it all, God, but use these tithes, these offerings, Father, to service into your kingdom, God, for the furtherment, Lord, of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross with the dearest and best, for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For it was 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and save them by me. So I cherish at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. And exchange it someday for a crown. Amen. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a praise. Amen. Boy, won't that be a time when we get to see Jesus. Amen. You may be seated tonight. I promise you I won't keep you long. I just got a short word for you tonight. And Shannon's graciously cooked us a wonderful meal across the street. Everybody's welcome. I don't know if we'll have enough, Shannon. I don't know. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. We're going to get in the Word tonight. Let's go to 1 John. 1 John chapter 5 tonight. Give June and our wonderful musicians, Brother Michael and Sister June, singing. Come on. Thank you. Thank y'all for being so faithful. I know this is a hard time. Man, COVID had come through our church, and I know it's kind of knocked people. What's wrong, baby? You want to preach? What's wrong with you, girl? You want June to sing another song? So I know everybody's been struggling in their body. I think I texted the whole church today, say, hey, I missed y'all today. And pretty much their blanket reply was, hey, we're just feeling rough. I said, hey, I know what you mean. It's a struggle to preach today. Angel, I had no idea. I said, Angel, said next time I get, I was so, when you have that COVID, it wrecks your lungs and it wears you out. Angel said, I looked like I was foaming at the mouth. I had like a dry spit on my mouth. So that's why I had this. I said, honey, you supposed to take care of your man. Why didn't you say something? But hallelujah, we're glad you're here tonight. The temperature is coming down. It was very hot. I was going to preach on hell. It was so hot, but the Lord changed my message. Just kidding. Let's go to the book of John, 1 John tonight, chapter 5. And I want to talk about faith victory. Now, everybody in here, we've experienced victory. We know what victory is. We live in victory. But I want to try to key on tonight on this little subject, having faith for victory. Let's just be honest. There's a lot of things that we have to deal with on a day-to-day basis that we don't have victory over. Maybe it's our job. Maybe it's a lost loved one. Maybe it's struggling to just find out where you need to be plugged in the kingdom of God. So I hope this sermon, or a short little sermonette, will bless you tonight. So let's go to 1 John chapter 5, verse 4 through 5. And I want you to key in, and don't really listen to the preacher. Listen to the preacher tonight, but listen to the word of God, Matthew. Let's pray. Father, I love you. I thank you for your word. It's anointed. It's blessed already. But Lord, help your servant tonight. Lord, I'm struggling a little bit in my voice. But Father, I feel an unction to preach this tonight, Lord. So I pray that somebody, Lord, will listen to it, God. Maybe there's someone in here struggling, Lord. So Father, be a blessing to them. You already are. But Father, just let them know that they're not in this fight alone, that the battle's not theirs. Lord, and let them have faith to receive that victory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's read. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. How many can lift your hand tonight and say, I am born of God, so I know I am an overcomer. And it says, and this is the victory that overcometh the world. Hallelujah. Even our faith. Let's read on. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Now, I don't want to get political, but I'm going to get political for a second. All these things that are going on in our world right now, it's not necessarily Republican or Democrat, Trump or Biden. It at the very root of it, it's designed to defeat or diminish the power that you and I as Christian believers have tonight. Have we so soon forgotten, Shannon, that you and I have been given power to tread over serpents, to drink any deadly thing, to lay hands on the sick, and know that they're not say, well, they might recover, Brother Michael. Know for a fact that they're going to recover. And above all of that, we are to go and to make disciples of all men, all nations, all tongues, all kindred. But let's just be real. This thing called COVID, coronavirus, it has really stalled the church. It has taken the winds out of our sails, spiritually speaking. But I'm glad that there's still some people tonight that even though you might not have the victory like you thought you were going going to have, you still have faith tonight that it's going to come out. And you're not only going to come out of this, but you're going to come out stronger. You're going to come out more anointed. You're going to come out seasoned. You're going to come out as a warrior that has been in battle. And when you face these little things that are going to come up against you in 2021, you're going to look at it and laugh and say, devil, if I come through 2020, I surely can make it through 20 and 21. We see here that John plainly states to the believer, it says, you're going to overcome the world. It didn't say you might. It didn't say that you had to do all these things. It said you will, if you are a believer, you will overcome the world. And this statement doesn't seem to harmonize with people that have been defeated. Let's just be honest. Have you been defeated before in your Christian walk? Man, yes. Felt defeated. As a pastor, when people leave the church, immediately the devil gets you in the mindset that it was what you said or what you did or what you didn't do. And you beat yourself up. And listen, you can lose sleep. You can, spiritually speaking, take a backseat. You begin to wonder. And not only as a pastor, but just as a Christian. Sometimes we feel like failures. But you got to get this word in you tonight, brothers and sisters of God, that if you're born of God, you're an overcomer. Look at your neighbor, even if you got to shout over a little way, and say, you're an overcomer, June. You're an overcomer, Dana. Hallelujah. So what is a defeated life? Here it is if you're taking notes. Number one, a defeated life, number one, is a life without fruit. Come on, somebody. Nothing more miserable, AJ, than look at someone that says they're saved, professes Christ, but yet they exhibit no fruit. I don't want to be like that. The Bible says in John chapter 15, verse 8, we are commanded by the Lord to bear fruit. Jesus says, herein is my Father glorified. John 15 and 8, Brother Stephen. It says, herein is my Father glorified, that you may bear what? Much fruit. And if you do that, so shall ye be my disciples. Someone say, I'm not gonna be fruitless this year, but I'm going to bear fruit. I'm going to be like a tree planted by the waters. I'm going to exhibit what my King has done. I'm going to show off to the world that I should have died. I should have been defeated. I should have locked the doors up. I should have quit. I should have quit paying my tithe. Hallelujah. But guess what? I'm bearing fruit because I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. Here it is, number two. What is the defeated life? Number one, a life without power. No, or excuse me, number one, a life without fruit. Number two, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, a life without power. You ever known someone that all they did is talk? I've been in that rut before where you talk a good game, but you don't follow through. Am I the only one? I think we've all been there sometime or enough. We've been there, but nevertheless, if you are a Christ follower, you not only have to bear fruit, but you have to exhibit power. Let's read in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Wasn't it beautiful, June, in the revival to see these young children baptized in the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues? It was beautiful to see that. But guess what? It doesn't matter how much you speak in tongues. It doesn't matter how hard you stomp your foot or you jump up. It matters, do you have the power to take authority over these things? One of our church members, it was Christmas Eve, they called me, and they're probably watching the live stream, and she said, Pastor, can you pray over my little daughter? She's been having dreams and all. And her name is Jade, and that's Zach and Shana's daughter. And I put her on the phone, and I said, and she's just such a sweet little girl. If you don't know her, she's a sweetheart. And I said, Jaden, how are you doing? She's like, I'm hearing these voices, Pastor. And I said, well, you know what? You know you have the power. And I said, we're going to do something. And she said, all right. I said, now you say what I say, but don't just say it. Believe it. Amen. What's the first verse we just read? He that is a believer overcomes the world. I'm a believer tonight, June. It doesn't matter. I don't want Biden to be my president. I don't want to live under a democratic rule the representation that we have right now. I don't want that for my kids. But nevertheless, whatever comes to pass, I am a believer that Jesus Christ, hallelujah, will supply my needs. He'll meet my needs physically, spiritually, and everything else that I might lack of, and I'm not going to get discouraged, and I'm not going to put my fruit tree up and say, well, Doom and gloom. We have nothing to look forward to. I'm looking forward to people joining the church. I'm looking forward to us building the church. I'm looking forward to people singing up here and shouting and dancing and people being saved. I don't know about y'all, but I'm excited for 2021. Hallelujah. Let's read a little bit further. Thirdly, a life without positive influence. How many? I know one of our friends just passed away, June, Brother Lynn Morse, and he was an encourager. I'm sure people butted heads with him over the years, as we all can butt heads, but I remember when I first went to Revival Tabernacle alongside him and many other people, they were really a great influence to me. They encouraged me. They didn't down me. They didn't beat me up, but they give me opportunities. June gave me opportunities. Pastor Gittins gave me opportunity. Never forget the people that have given you a positive influence. Why? Because that moment you. That makes you who you are. Here's another one. What is a defeated life? A life dominated by the flesh. Here it is. A life dominated by the flesh. You know anybody like that? The flesh keeps them down. The flesh suppresses them. The flesh keeps them from doing anything spiritual. Paul said this right here in the Gospels. He said he called them babes in Christ. They're babes in Christ. And listen, you and I as positive influencers, you and I as people with power, you and I with people that are bearing much fruit, we must identify these babes in Christ and seclude them. Hallelujah. And let them grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Matthew, I love your little kids, but can I get on you just for a second? A lot of times, y'all might not see it, but your kids will run towards that door. And you know what? I have a fear that they're going to hit that knob, and they're going to jet towards the road, and God forbid, something dangerous is out there. But spiritually speaking, when you are a babe in Christ, if you don't allow full access to the Holy Ghost to come in your life and overshadow you and watch after you, guess what? You have potential to go out there and be run over by the world. But aren't you glad that he's a very present help? Psalms 46 and 1. Aren't you glad tonight that Psalms 91 and 10 and 11 says he gives his angels charge over thee? He will not leave us comfortless. He wants to help us tonight. He wants to facilitate us. Here's the last one, another one. A life directed by Satan. Come on. Oh God, I don't want to ever think that my life is directed by the enemy. But I will say this, I have played into the tactics of the enemy before. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 and 9. We quoted this this morning. Be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary as a roaring lion seeks who he may devour. But I want you to key in on verse 9, my friend. Verse 9, let's read this tonight. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Listen, what you've been through, what we're going through, 2020 didn't take the Messiah. It didn't take God by surprise, Brother Michael. God knew exactly what was coming down the pipe. Could it be that God allowed this thing called COVID, this thing called coronavirus, to come in our land to really get people to see, are we really where we think we are as a Christian society? Are we really leaning on the arm of the Lord, or are we more or less leaning on the arm of the flesh? Come on. James says this in James 4 and 7. He says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and what? He shall flee from you. See, listen, one that doesn't have fruit, one that doesn't think he has power, one that is influenced by the flesh and is an agent of Satan, it is so easy to not heed to the word of God. But someone say, we got to submit tonight. I'm so glad that we have a church that is submitted. It's a blessing to pastor people that are submitted. But can I just be real with you? Not everybody's submitted in AIF. Not everybody is on fire for God. Not everybody might not be where you are, Jim. Spiritually, they might not know the scriptures like you. They might not have a shout like you, Dana. They might not be a prayer warrior like you, Angel. But nevertheless, do we put them on the outside? Do we count them as there's no hope in them? No. As Christians, we have to encourage one another. We have to say, honey, I see you slipping, but I want you to have what I have. Amen. It's called faith victory. You got to have enough faith to believe that that person is going to experience the depths of victory as you have. Amen. Someone say amen, Pastor. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. A life dictated by the world. Oh, I don't want to preach on this, but I'm going to go ahead and say it. There's a lot of Christians that look more like the world than the Word. Oh, that is sad. You know what? We're in a time like this. One of my favorite pastors that have already went on and passed away, John Wilkerson. I know you, or excuse me, David Wilkerson. Y'all know who I'm talking about. If you've not, look him up. And he preached this message about 12, 13 years ago. And you've heard many pastors talk about it. But they hired these people. They're called seeker-friendly churches, and they're around right now. I can name the names, but you already know what I'm talking about. There are these big churches. They appeal to the flesh. The pastors look like someone in the club. The church is painted up like a club. There's no hard preaching in there. There's no confrontational preaching in there. And it's where someone can be in sin, living in the world, married to the world, and they can come in and sit through a service and not feel one iota of conviction. Amen? Why is it? It's because, listen, people are afraid to preach the truth. Can someone say amen?
Amen.
I don't want my life to be dictated by the world. I want my life to be dictated by the Word of God. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15, it says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Listen, the apostle here, he's indicating that there is a great danger in loving the world. Therefore, he warns the children of God against it. I don't know about y'all, but I'm going to warn my children if there's imminent danger outside of these walls. Michael, you're my great friend. Richard, you're my great friend. Shannon, you're my friend. June, you're my friend. And if you knew something bad was coming my way, not only on my behalf, but your mind would be on Angel and your mind would be on my children and how it could be destructive, you would warn me. You would tell me. You would text me. You would call me. You would get in your vehicle and beat on my door until I come to the door and you would say, Richie, something bad's coming. Amen. I believe Christians today, we need to warn people of the things that are coming, but not scare them, but give them the good news of Jesus Christ. That, listen, I'm a believer and I'm an overcomer by faith. And not only I, but you also. I will bear in the altar with you your problem. I will give you hope. I will give you peace. And I will lift up your feeble hands and I will pray you through whatever it takes. I'll have faith for you. Come on. You ever been in a situation where you're on the other side of the coin, where you needed that friend to help you, where you needed that worship leader under the anointing of the Holy Ghost? You've come in here and you're like, man, I just need a song. I'm depressed. I don't feel your preaching today, Pastor. I love you, but I'm not feeling your message. But then June will get on that piano and she'll hear from heaven. The Holy Ghost will move through her fingers, through the singers up here, through the musicians, and they'll begin to sing a heavenly song. A psalm is what the Bible calls it, and it'll resonate in your heart and it'll pick you up, and you'll say, you know what? I'm going to lift my hands in faith tonight, and I'm going to go ahead and claim my victory, because greater is He. We got to live like that, Michael. We go on and says in James chapter 4, verse 4, in a stronger way, the apostle James says here, right here, James 4 and 4, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is what? Enmity with God. I don't know about y'all, but I don't want my wife texting another man. I don't want my wife meeting up with another man. And I'm going to tell you what, if I knew someone was trying to squeeze and weasel their way in to my wife, oh, you think I would sit there by the wayside? Mm-mm. I would do whatever I had to do, Tony, to protect the integrity of my marriage vows, because I love that woman. Amen. She's not second fiddle. She's not third fiddle. She is the apple of my eye. She is part of me. The two shall become one flesh. Let no man put asunder what God has joined together. Don't let any devil. And it goes a step higher. When you are married to Jesus, when you have committed and submitted and confessed Him as Lord and Savior, you don't backslide on Him. You don't let anything play second fiddle. James says this. He says, James 4 and 4, do you not know that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world, I don't like this, is an enemy of God. The apostle Paul, knowing the greater danger, knowing the greater sin, he says, listen here, Christian's life is not dictated by the world, but it says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. I have some friends, and they're like, you don't listen to, you haven't seen that movie? You don't listen to that song? You don't listen to that rock song? No, I don't. I tried my best to be an example unto my children that we are godly people, that we serve God and we serve none other. Paul said this, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. He said, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. See, we use that. I remember old time, Matthew, you're the only one in here of color, but people, Christians have used this scripture for years and years to say, well, whites shouldn't marry blacks, and blacks shouldn't marry white, and Hispanics should. They use this verse, but that is not what it means. It means that we shouldn't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. I shouldn't be hanging out at the strip clubs trying and then be in church on Sunday. Come on. I shouldn't be at the bar drinking on Thursday night and in the pulpit on Wednesday. It just wouldn't work. God would strike me dead. Y'all would see that something has changed in me, and y'all would leave the church. I pray. But listen, Paul's saying here, let's read this. It says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion have light with darkness? I love having godly friends. June, I don't get to see you much, but every time, listen, if you've never been over to June's house, you don't just show up, set up an appointment. But I love when I come over to June's house, you never know what her house is going to look like. She changes it up. I don't know how often, but it's pretty often. But every time I go in there, that house has just a spirit about it, a beautiful spirit. If it's Christmas, you know it's Christmas when you walk in there. If it's Easter, you know it's Easter. And I've been to a lot of others' houses in here, and it's the same feeling. When you walk in that place, you know that you're in a believer's house. Beyond a shadow of a doubt, you don't have to go to the refrigerator and look for the liquor bottle. You don't have to worry about them hiding the drugs or anything else. You know that you're entering in a place that is conducive for Christian fellowship. That's the beauty of being saved, y'all. That's the beauty of being saved, Matthew, when maybe you are struggling to have victory in a certain area of your life. I don't condemn you. I don't look at you in a different way. But when I enter in your presence, I can go back to the place where maybe I was defeated. But then I remember, the Holy Ghost says, you remember how I gave you victory in that area of your life? And then I begin to minister to you. Galatians chapter 6 and 1 talks about that. I begin to minister grace to you, not by me, but by the power of the Holy Ghost. Let's read this. Galatians 6 and 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken of fault, ye which are spiritual, ye which are steeped, ye which are fruit bearers, ye which have power, ye that have not a mind of the flesh, but you're of the spiritual nature. It says, restore someone like Richie. Restore someone that's down and out. Restore someone that's got a bad report from the doctor, say it's cancer. And even though you're not some miraculous faith healer, you know the God of Isaac. You know the God of Jacob. You know the God that's healed Guillain-Barre syndrome. You know people in the church that are almost 90 years old that battled COVID and they're still alive. They beat the statistics. They beat the CNN news broadcasters. They beat, hallelujah, the Fox News. All the naysayers and the doubters and the grumblers and the complainers. Oh, yeah. I'm a believer tonight, so that makes me an overcomer. I have full access to faith. I have full access to victory. I have full access to 2021. Why? Because I'm not a bastard. I am a son. You are a daughter. You and I together are joint believers with Christ Jesus. And if that don't make you shout, I don't know how to get you to shout tonight. Hallelujah. We read on in verse 17. Go to verse 17. Please, sir, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. Oh, I feel like I'm getting frothy at the mouth again, Angel. Here we go. Let's read this. So what do you do if you find yourself in a faithless situation? What if you feel yourself, instead of having victory, you have discouragement and defeat? Check your circle. Amen. Check your circle. Y'all know my little stories. I used to love watching that, whatever, I can't remember, Deadliest Catch. I love watching them fishermen catch them crabs. But my wife broke me from it. She's like, look, they're not cussing, but they are. You're just hearing the bleep, 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 bleep. And it sounds like Morse code. Turn it off. We don't watch it anymore. And that made me mad. Why? Because flesh does not want to go the way of God. Did we not just read that? It's enmity. You don't want what God wants. God wants the good. I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith God. Jeremiah 29:11. Abigail, can you quote the rest? For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith God. Thoughts of peace to give you? Yes. Yeah, and another version says this, for I know the plans I have for you, plans to give you hope and a future. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful that God, he wants me to, he has hope and he knows the plan. He can see it through, but guess what? He wants us to realize that. Oh, that's so beautiful. There's nothing more beautiful than having your children look at you and say, Daddy, I know you have the best intentions for me. I know you're working hard and you're not buying stuff for yourself, but you're putting up for my college. And that's awesome when your kids know that you believe in them. How many had a parent that believed in you? They just believed in you. They encouraged you. I was raised up in a household where it's kind of weird, very strict household, very regimented household. And my mom and dad, we're the type of family, you go out to take the trash. I love you, son. Love you too, Mom. You go to the grocery store. Love you, Dad. Did anybody grow up like that? Or maybe you didn't grow up like that. I grew up in a loving home, but a very strict home. It's hard to explain, but I also grew up in a home where my dad never did ever give me much affirmation. I raced BMX bikes. I was a couple races, I think about six races, for becoming a professional. I got all the way up to beginner, intermediate. I went through all that, and I got up to almost to get my pro card. And my dad, he never hardly come to, I'm not trying to give you a pity party. What I'm trying to say is my dad never gave me much encouragement. And now I know why, because some people, if they don't have encouragement, then it's like that's the only thing they live for. But you gotta go through life. Nobody's going to encourage you. People are going to fail you. People are not going to be on your team, but you got to know, and I know this sounds cliche, and I know people say, oh, that's good, I've never seen God, but guess what? The King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, Jesus the Christ, he is for you. Romans 8:31, if God be for you, then who can be against you? That is beautiful to know that I have Jesus on my side, and he's for me. I'm not saying my dad was a bad man. He just didn't give out many compliments. But I remember not long before he died, he looked me dead in the eye and he said, son, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of what you're doing. I'm proud of you and your wife. I'm proud of the church. You're a great man. And that, you know what? I feel like he gave me $3 million because I've never heard my dad give me that much affirmation. But when he gave me that, I was like, woo! Thank God, I've been trying to please you all my life, and finally, here before you're fixing to die, you finally let me know that you see that I'm doing something good. Look at your neighbor tonight and tell me you love him. Love you. Amen. Can you do that? Can you really just tell somebody, I love you? Amen. Listen, there's so many people right now that are suicidal, that have committed suicide, and they just need to know that they're loved by the Father. Angel, how many? I got two calls last week. Angel was with me on one of people that don't even go to church here. People that don't even know me. People called me and said, Pastor, we after we got out of quarantine, we went to Best Buy to get a gift for Abigail. And Lord knows, I was outside of the truck for 30 minutes talking on the phone. And here's a guy. He's suicidal. His brother committed suicide, and now he's suicidal. He feels like no one loves him, feels like God is so far from him. And I didn't have the right words, Tony. I didn't know what to say to that man. I had no clue. I just began to tell him what the Holy Ghost put in my heart. And he's still here tonight. I'm not saying that he's not going to struggle with this for however long, but what I'm here to say tonight is we have to give people hope. Amen. It's called faith victory. It means I have enough faith tonight as a believer. I've got enough fruit. I've got enough power. I've got a general understanding of the word that you can have the same victory that I have tonight. Amen. Let me close this down the home stretch. A defeated life is dominated by the world, the flesh, and the devil. Listen to this. These three enemies, they will work for constant defeat in your life. You hear that? A life dominated by the world, the flesh, and the devil. Those are three things that you're going to have to fight till the day you see Jesus. God wants you to be victorious. Satan wants you to be defeated. It's simple as that. Your soul is beyond his reach, but you can still be touched through the world and his subtle suggestions. I'm going to tell you what. We oftentimes, it just takes one little word. One little word. How many's ever been destroyed for a moment by one single word? Yes. Isn't that terrible? Jesse, I would use our example, but I think I've used that so many times. But can I use it one more time? I see her smiling. She's my sister-in-law. I'll never forget. It's been how many years? 4 or 5 years ago. It's been a while. And we were sitting at the table, and Jesse was just, I could tell she was looking at me. I'm like, what is she looking at? And then she just said it. She's like, Richie, your hair is turning gray. What'd you say, Jesse? 8 years ago, she's like, God, you're beginning to get a lot of gray hair. And I'm going to tell you what, when she said that, I was like, I'm not defeated. I don't have gray hair. In my spirit, I was like, I'm still 38. Now I'm 43. And I began to realize that, yes, I do have gray hair now. It's just part of me. A lot. Michael said a lot. June, have you ever been looked over before? People look over you? And you're sitting in the back there and you're thinking, well, I've been faithful here for 45 years. I might be stretching the time, but I've been here since the beginning. I've been here for everything, and you're just looking me over. I'm glad you're not looked over here. We love you and we appreciate you. But have you ever felt looked over? You ever felt like you were second best, third best? See, that's how the devil, in a subtle manner, comes by and he puts some seed of doubt in there. Come on, y'all. Here's the close. I'm gonna close it up for us tonight because we have a great meal over there waiting. I can't wait to get it. I hope everyone's able to stay. Let's recap. What a dead drag it is to be around a defeated Christian. Can someone please say amen?
Amen.
It is absolutely a drag. You ever been around those types of Christians? I won't even mention any names, but I've talked to some people the last couple of weeks, and by their mannerisms and their replies, I would not think 1 minute those people were saved. You ever answer the phone and someone says, hey, yeah, what do you want? I'm just going to leave it right there. Love y'all. Yeah. You ever been around? God forgive me, Lord. I'm human. I just say what's on my mind, Father. I've been in this church before, and before the worship starts, especially on Wednesday night, people get here early, and they're just talking. And listen, your talk sets the tone of the atmosphere. Listen, nobody had to be told it was 80-plus degrees in here when you walked in here tonight. Why? Because somebody, whatever happened, went over to the thermostat, and they took the heat to the high level. See, listen, it's imperative that we get this. Everywhere you and I go, we have to exhibit or represent an ambassador. I remember a little Baptist boy. I was saved in a Baptist church, and we didn't have Royal Rangers. We had Royal Ambassadors, and they drilled that into us. You are an ambassador. Everywhere you go, the way you look, the way you comb your hair, the way you speak, you are a representation of Jesus Christ. And listen, how true that is. We are ambassadors. When you get into a place that people don't have victory, you don't fall in their little trap and begin to have a pity party with them. You begin to talk about the goodness of God. You begin to think on these things that can change their situation. Amen. What if you got bad news that you had cancer? And Richard, I know you don't have cancer. Please don't think I'm saying that you do. But what if you got a bad report and I come here and say, my goodness, Richard. Oh, God, I just need to tell you this one thing. I have an uncle, he didn't last 3 months. Wow. What's your symptoms? Exactly. Yes. Thank you for the boldness. Can I be real with you? Kimberly, God bless you. It's okay now, but we did have several people have COVID in here. And I'm going to tell you what, every phone call I will get, I begin to be like, oh, Lord. Is this sweat? Is it a fever? Is this congestion? Is it Rona? Is that you? we begin to think like that. Begin to say, you know, is this symptom? It could have just been a whatever. But how easily the enemy can come in a subtle manner. See, did the devil? How did he? And you can come to the piano because I'm done. I'm done. Or if you want to play a song or however you want to do it. Let's have an altar call, but how did the devil come in and deceive Adam and Eve? Did he roll up on the scene and say, I'm the devil, I'm Lucifer? Did he sing a song? Did he set that? No. Yes, sir. Amen. That's good. You've been reading your Bible. He slithered in. In this thing called life, the devil will sliver in. How does he mess up marriages? He slivers in here when you're not looking. How does he get someone to lie? he slips in. Has anyone ever told a lie in here? But see, listen, we're an overcomer. Someone needs to put, can you role play with me for a second? Can you take your hand and put it on your chest and say this with me tonight, everybody? Say, I am an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of my testimony. And even if I have to lose my life for the sake of the cross, it's worth it. By faith, I'm an overcomer. By faith, I have victory tonight. Even when my flesh doesn't see it, I am victorious. In Jesus' name. All right, let's stand to our feet. I want to close out with this last saying right here before we open the altars. Here's something that we don't do, Kimberly, but we ought to do it. How many remembers young men? You know what I'm talking about. You remember as a young man, you wanted to have a beard like your daddy? What did we all do? We went in the bathroom, we shaved, kept shaving, shave. And then before long, you was like, man, I wish I would have never shaved the first time because now I got to shave every day, sometimes twice a day. But listen, this is what the Bible says. The Bible says that you have to build yourself up sometimes. I'm paraphrasing. But you need to get your spiritual mirror out and look in it and say, God, search me tonight. Create in me a clean heart, oh God. Have a spiritual one-on-one with God. How do we do that? At the altar. And say, God, maybe I've not had enough faith. Maybe I've been a little down. Maybe I've watched so much CNN and Fox News that I don't even know where I stand anymore. I'm worried. I'm weary. Amen. Won't you make it sure tonight? Leave out of this place invigorated with newfound faith, with newfound victory in Jesus' name. You can pray at your pew. You can come to the altar tonight. But if you have a need, trust Jesus Christ can meet that need tonight. Amen. Would you come and pray tonight? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing, Father. Thank you for giving us victory tonight.
I just live from day to day, and I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. For I know what lies ahead, and today you'll walk beside me, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand,
All right. Beautiful, beautiful singing today. I hope you enjoyed the sermon tonight. Amen. How many's got faith? Amen. Faith, victory. Amen. Hope you have an awesome, awesome rest of your evening. If everyone is able to stay, I know we have plenty to eat across the street. Kimberly, you're welcome to stay also, my friend, if you'd like to eat with us. And that goes for everybody in here. If I don't get to say goodbye to you, I love you, and I appreciate each and every one of you. Don't forget, tomorrow we do have prayer meeting at 7 o'clock. 7 o'clock we have a prayer meeting, and there's not a set service length you have to pray. There's many people come. And they pray, and then they just help themselves out. So I hope to see you tomorrow. If not, I understand. Hope you have an awesome, awesome week. Amen. All hearts and minds free and clear. Let's all stand tonight. Abigail Lydia dismiss us in prayer.